Hi, my name's Josh, and today we're here with the museum's curator of beetles, Max Barclay, in the beetle collection, where we'll be talking a bit more and in a lot more depth about fireflies and glowworms. If you haven't checked out our recent video on why fireflies glow, then check out the link in the description below. But today, we're just going to go a bit more in depth into sort of fireflies and glowworms and sort of why they do it and how they do it, I guess. A good place, I think, to start would be to reiterate the difference between glowworms and fireflies, because they're not quite the same thing, are they?
Well, yes, that's right. And fireflies and glowworms both belong to the family Lampyridae, which is a group of beetles, about 2,000 species worldwide. And some of them are able to fly, and some of them are not. And in some species, the female is flightless and the male is able to fly.
Okay.
And usually we use the word glowworm for a non-flying glowing Lampyridae.
Okay.
And firefly for a flying glowing Lampyridae.
Okay. Wow. So it's, yeah, okay. So one of them is acting like a fly and one of them is acting like a worm.
Yes, yes, exactly.
But they're both beetles.
They're both actually beetles. Okay. That's right.
And so we've got some examples here to show everyone. These ones are specifically from the UK, right?
Yes, that's right. This is the British species, the glowworm, which is found on well-drained soils, usually in the south of England.
Okay.
You'll find it on the chalk downlands and places like that. And this is a classic glowworm in that the female is completely wingless and crawls amongst the grass, emitting a faint greenish glow. Looks a little bit like a cigarette end or like a star that's fallen from the sky. It depends on your poetic tendencies. But the male is able to fly but unable to glow and is flying around looking for the glow of the females.
So the female is glowing to attract a mate, is
that's
that the way
correct,
it's
yes.
Yeah, okay, so if we're looking, so which ones?
So these are the females here, which are flightless. And then the males are a little bit smaller and they have these long wings and they have no glowing organ. So some of these have been mounted upside down show the glowing organ at the end, where they mix the chemicals. They mix the luciferin and luciferase together to make the cold glow.
And it's like a, would you say it's like a greeny light, is that
right? Yes, that's right. Yeah. And it's a signal to the opposite sex.
So that's in the UK, we only have glowworms, but in other parts of the world, it's slightly different, isn't it? So,
Well, you get into warmer places, even in Spain and Italy and Portugal, you'll start seeing fireflies.
Okay.
And that is things which are flying through the air and glowing at the same time, or you'll get trees lit up with hundreds of them. And really places like Thailand and Malaysia, it's a little bit of a spectacle, really, where you go and see these illuminated trees with thousands of fireflies all glittering in the trees. And what they're doing, of course, is they're having a big mating party, and the females are attracting the males with the light. And the males in many species of firefly also produce a light, and they reciprocate, so they'll flash at each other.
So it's almost like a sort of courtship.
Well, that's right, that's right. And if the flashing pattern is right, then they'll recognize that it's the correct species.
Oh, cool.
And then they'll go in and mate. But like all systems in biology, this has been subverted in some cases. And this is the North American genus Photurus. And these are called femme fatale fireflies because instead of, or as well as, producing the glow that would attract an appropriate mate, they also produce an imitation of the glow of another species in order to lure in the males of this genus, Photinus, who come in to the specific glowing signal thinking that they're going to find a mate of their own species, and actually they're going to be eaten.
That's amazing.
So the females are using the glow to attract prey, which is males of different species.
That's very cool.
They then sequester some chemicals from the prey males, which make them more defended against their own predators. And it's been shown that female Photurus that have eaten a lot of male Photinus are less palatable to spiders and frogs and other predators. So it gives them a good biological advantage to eat as many males of the other genus that they can get.
So it's almost like a similar system to what some people at home might know about the frogs eating ants to sort of steal their poison as well.
Yes, that's right. I mean, the female Photurus is collecting and eating the male Photinus not only to get a meal, but also to collect the chemicals from the Photinus and use them to defend herself from her own enemies.
That's really cool. I like that a lot. And obviously these are, you know, these are quite, I guess, modest-sized beetles, but there are some other bigger versions which are also able to...
Well, some of the biggest glowing beetles are the fireflies that are showed in the end here. And those, and also These are the glowing click beetles of South America. And they're distantly related to the other fireflies, but they also produce a very bright glow in the same way. And they produce it while they're in flight. So these are sort of part of the cultural landscape in a lot of the countries where they occur, because you've got these brightly glowing things flying through the night.
I bet. Why wouldn't you be talking about those sorts of things?
Well, I guess.
And you mentioned they're sort of distantly really related. Is it quite, so how many different groups of beetles are able to produce light?
Well, there's at least three different groups of beetles, possibly four, that are able to produce light. And they all belong to the same basic taxonomic group, but there are thousands of beetles in that group that don't produce any light. So this has appeared maybe three or four times in evolution in the beetles.
Yeah, nice. There are other examples of like cultural importance of beetles, right? Am I correct in thinking that? I mean, we've got a tray here from Thailand, I think.
Well, this is a tray here of glowworms and fireflies from Thailand. And in Thailand, you get these fantastic displays where the trees are illuminated with thousands of glowing fireflies. And this has got some cultural interest. People go and tourists go and see them glowing. And the queen, the wife of the late king, she dedicated a national park called the Queen Sirikit Botanic Gardens, which was full of fireflies. But we have two specimens here that were collected by His Royal Highness, the Prince of Champong, in 1921. So that was another member of the Thai royal family who was interested in fireflies.
That's very cool. It's got some royal beetles.
Yes. Beetles collected by a member of the royal family.
Very exciting. Well, thank you so much for giving us a sort of a very small glimpse of the very big beetle collection here and some of the amazing sort of life histories of fireflies.
Well, yes, they're a very diverse group, and there's only 2,000 or so species, which sounds like a lot, but in terms of beetles, it's actually quite a small family, because there are about 400,000 different named beetles. And here in the Natural History Museum, we have a good representative collection of many of these.
Well, I had a great time talking to Max about glowworms and fireflies. And if you enjoyed it, how about you let us know in the comments below? And as always, if you liked what you see, then don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe.